So when we're dealing with augmented reality, it's all about activating the spatial cognition of our users. It activates that spatial part of their brain, and they're finding things and looking at things in space. And because of that, it's important that when you design these experiences, you're designing with that spatial cognition on the go. The story that I'm reminded of is Google Glass, the original, the first Google Glass. A journalist took it out and she was in the supermarket looking at these overlays, these visualizations, and lost track of her kids because she was, I think she was checking her email at one point. And one of the things that can help you kind of keep the experience in balance or in harmony with the spaces so you don't lose your kids is to walk the space. What we mean by walk the space is when you're designing for space, explore it and imagine how your hologram or story will unfold. Like go there, go outside, go downtown. If it's for a hospital, go to a hospital. If it's for a waiting room, go to a waiting room and see what opportunities you have to design in that space. See what constraints are there. So that's called walking the space. AR is in motion with the real world. It's important that you support an unobstructed peripheral vision, meaning that there's no frame to the world, so that if a user turns and moves, your objects act and feel right. It's not just about keeping them in frame. You can use your front-facing camera on your device to anticipate real-life events as well and react to those. And remember that AR is also designed for longer term wear than VR, where VR is like a 10, maybe 20 minute experience, maybe longer if it's like a gaming situation. AR is typically longer in the day, even though the experiences might be shorter bursts interrupted by real life, but then someone might have that device for a longer period of time. At least that's the idea with AR. Remember that you also want to think about contrast. So if you're on a very light background, if you're outdoors, make sure that your text is sensitive. Think about that more as the way we think about mobile responsive design or what we call adaptive design. So for example, adapting to the conditions that your camera is sensing. So if it's a dark environment, use white text, high contrast, that type of thing. And it's also important that you think about the object shadowing and the realism of objects, that they throw the right kind of shadows and feel realistic. It's also important that your physics is realistic. Now, AR utilizes SLAM, which is simultaneous localization and mapping, which models the environment. It's got LIDAR as well, which is a light detection and ranging technology. Essentially, it's bouncing off of the environment, modeling it in polygons, in geometry, and then allowing you to do things with that, like utilize the actual physics. We also have the introduction of hand-tracked motions and hand-tracked gestures. So these virtual objects can be part of this and you can interact with them. And that's the potentially magical thing about AR. Think about this whole design problem though, the spatial cognition, as like driver distraction. Only the difference is that someone's moving around, right? And when someone's driving, they're actually, their eyes are moving around, but with AR, you're actually moving around in the physical environment. So short bursts of attention is really important to support, as well as designing in space, in the actual space, walking the space when you're doing it, so that you can lower the risk of a high task load. Speaking of task load, NASA has a really nice task load index scale. It's called NASA TLX. Take a look at, you can actually download NASA's app and you can run through it. It's like a questionnaire. You can use it when you're designing, but you can also use it to evaluate your experience afterward. And it's basically mental demand, physical demand, temporal demand. And these are perfect. Those three are perfect for AR: mental demands, physical demands, you know, the context, as well as time-based. So for example, interruptions on that temporal one. And they also measure against performance, effort, and frustration. So I think NASA TLX is a really nice scale that you can adapt or use as you're designing.